Hello, I'm Toycat, and welcome back to another second channel geography video. This is Evan's series where I talk about geography and the world and stuff. And today, I'm going to be continuing on my series where I talk about every single border that a country does have. I feel like it's a pretty valuable way for you to understand a country's motifs and conflicts within a region. And given that Egypt exists in one of the most conflict-filled regions with some of the most bizarre borders, seriously, it shares borders with 3 or 4 separate countries, and they're all mostly straight lines. It seriously has some of the straightest borders in the world. It even has a 90-degree angle tripoint, but with Libya and Sudan, or a 180-degree tripoint. Seriously, look at these borders, they're crazy, and how does it not cause Egypt problems, you might wonder? Well, that's something I figured I'd explain in today's video, as well as, you know, how it has some of the weirdest terror disputes in the world, including one with Sudan, which leads to Bertawil, one of the few terra nullises in the world. That's right, there is a place here where anyone can start a country, because it's a border dispute where neither, you know, side claims it, which means in today's video, it's not only a guide to Egypt's borders, but it's also a guide to how you can start your own country, in theory at least. So, yeah, hopefully you do all enjoy it. Let's get straight into explaining Egypt as a whole, because I feel like to understand Egypt's border situation, you have to understand the geography of the borders themselves and the geography of the country itself, really. Because again, you might have learned somewhere in history class or from a TV show or a movie or whatever else that Egypt is a desert-filled country, but I feel like, you know, looking at a visual overview of the map, that helps you to really understand just how much desert there really is. So again, you can see right here around the Nile, there's mostly green, you know, proper farmland area because of the irrigation from the Nile. However, the rest of the country is mostly just filled with deserts. And the best way to really illustrate this, besides just here is what it looks like from a satellite, is this map right here showing the population density. So as you can see, even Egypt has 90 million people, but they all mostly live around the Nile in this huge you know, metropolitan area. And then the rest of the country has between 0 and 5 people per square kilometer, including the border with Sudan, interestingly, because there's a few oases in there, but it's mostly just desert where no one can live even if they wanted to. So yeah, that is the deal with Egypt and its geography. It also is interesting, well, interestingly, one of the few transcontinental countries, if you believe Africa and Asia are separate continents, which most of you watching this video probably do. It separates down the middle by the Suez Canal right here. So again, Suez Canal is quite famous for causing some diplomatic incidents in the 60s, but it is the canal which divides Asia and Africa, even though it's man-made, which kind of ruins things. But whatever, it is technically the divide between Asia and Africa, and it allows for shipping between Asia and between Europe. So it's pretty darn valuable, as you can expect. And it's found in the middle of Egypt, which is one of the reasons for Egypt's success. And yeah, therefore, there's the mainland of Egypt, and there's also the Sinai Peninsula, which is partially a Arabic slash, Middle East or Asian country, whatever you want to call it, and the country as a whole is also Arabic. However, the key thing you also need to understand about Egypt is its history, because I only understood really, you know, for most of my life that, like, oh yeah, Egypt is the place where Egyptians came from, that super advanced civilization, and then they did something for maybe 2,000 to 3,000 years, and then here they are today with the Arab Spring and stuff. So in between, Egypt obviously had a downfall in power, and it was actually a part of the British Empire. That's something you learn, you know, like it shows up on maps and you're like, oh yeah, it's part of the British Empire, right? But the truth is it's a bit more complex than that, because Egypt was never quite just like a British subject or whatever. It was technically an Egyptian British condominium. So Egypt was at the time owned by, you know, like partially Egypt and partially the UK. Again, condominiums are complex, but it was partially owned by both. And then Sudan, the country to the south, also found within the British Empire, I think you'll notice, was actually partially owned by that Egyptian-British condominium, and then partially owned by the British too. Again, exactly why that happens is just like complex international politics, but it means that essentially both of these areas were part of the British Empire, some more indirectly than others. So when it came to draw a border between the two, again, this is really kind of important stuff, Egypt kind of figured, you know, the British kind of figured like, oh, we own both these places anyway, and it's massively just desert between the two. Like, again, there's some population centers along the Nile, but besides that, it's just mostly desert. Let's just draw a straight line along the 22nd parallel. And although this has worked in a few places before, notably the US and Canada, have a straight line border, works out for them. In this case, it worked out mostly, again, for most of the border it's fine, but it did cause two issues. The first issue was the Halaib Triangle, this area right here, where, again, the people there considered themselves Sudanese and Sudan wanted the area, and it caused the second issue off the, you know, like, along the Nile with the Nubian people, because, again, there were quite a few Nubian villages here, 52 of them to be precise, that all got destroyed, that's later, but that were all on the Egyptian side of the border, even though they, again, were part of the Sudan country, and therefore, 3 years later, in 1902, you know, the British came along again and were like, wait, okay, we drew the border long, border wrong, but a straight line, let's fix it. So they kept the straight line mostly in this border, but they fixed the big issues they came across, and then they also gave Berta will to the Egyptian as kind of like a trade-off for that. So again, Sudan got this little salient right here, which is internationally just recognized as theirs, and then Egypt, and in return, got the Berta will, and then Sudan also got the Halabib Triangle. However, even though, again, it was agreed by the British like that, Egypt went independent, and Egypt stopped following those borders entirely. In fact, Egypt to this day just claims, oh, there was only ever one border. There's the 1899 border, which is like this, and there's no other border since then. So that means that Egypt claims the border is a straight line all the way across, and that Sudan claims the border, again, looks like the British one, which leads to the very interesting situation where both of these areas are disputed. They, you know, both countries want both these areas. However, this area right here, neither country wants it. And the reason neither country wants it is because to claim, Berta will, to say that this area belongs to them, would be saying that, you know, the Halab Triangle, and this would not. Again, you'd have to accept a different set of boundaries, which is not something either side wants to do. And the reason neither side wants it, even though, like, you know, you might say, well, I mean, it's useful like that, but why not settle something there? And that the simple explanation to that is like, well, it's literally nothingness. So although you can technically start a country here, because neither country would be able to stop you diplomatically, although they'd have to get together and like fix that in some way. Although technically you can start a country here and try and play the politics game, the truth is a lot of people have tried to do that, but getting here is absurdly difficult. It's not connected to any major infrastructure from either side. It's miles away from the nearest airport or road or anything like that. It's just a big stretch of desert. Again, like the number of people who have been there in their lifetimes is depressingly low probably. So yeah, basically getting to the area in the first place, very tricky. And then getting people to recognize you is the key part, because many people have claimed the area, and you know, a couple of people have even been there to like physically plant a flag, but the truth is you need international recognition to be considered a country. So how do you start a country? First of all, you find terra nullius. The one example we have is right here. Then you go to the country, you put your flag down, and then you use your help of your superpower friends, you know, hopefully your friends of Russia, maybe China, maybe the UK, maybe the US. You get a superpower on your side, and then they can claim it's totally real, get a few other countries on the side, and then suddenly you've got yourself a brand new country. So there you go, there's an idea, there's how you can make a country with Berta will, the one piece of land that no one wants, because you'd have to get rid of land that you actually do want. So let's talk about the two disputed areas, because again, the border is otherwise straight besides these disputed areas, and I find them fascinating, and you know, Egypt just claims they're straight anyway, let's ignore that. So I find them fascinating because the Halab Triangle, even though they fight over it, it's mostly just some land with like a few people living there. Again, it sounds like, oh yeah, billions of people, not billions, but millions of people must live there, right? No, there's a very tiny settlement called Halab, which is where the name of the triangle comes from. And although a few people live here, you can see it's mostly, you know, like, not much going on there either. It's mostly just like, well, there's something there, and there's something of value, and there's land, and maybe later it'll be something. So both sides want it for that reason. However, it's not highly populated. However, the other side of things, this is like one of those, like, crazy situations, because there was previously a lot of Nubian people that lived here, and the reason they came under the Sudanese is because, you know, they were connected directly to Sudanese infrastructure, but they weren't to Egyptians. However, the Egyptians, because they claim it's theirs, they flooded all the villages, and they got rid of it and turned it into a huge lake, which is used for power and stuff, like it's useful, but yeah, they just got rid of all those villages, and I don't know, pretty terrible, I guess. I I feel like you can say that, right? Like all of these villages just destroyed, and yeah, that's a thing that happened that makes their border now exist over water and makes it less, you know, contentious. Like, you know, does it matter who owns this water now? Because it all flows into Sudan anyway. Not really, but Sudan keeps the claim and Egypt's just like, whatever. Like, it's not, that's why it doesn't show up on maps. So there you go, fun fact right there. Also, as an interesting fact, OpenStreetMap, a lot of people say like, don't use Google Maps for borders, even though with straight lines it's fine. OpenStreetMap just claims the Egyptian side on this matter, so it's a straight line, but then they claim the Sudanese side, and then they also say, you know, Berta will belongs to no one. So there you go, in case you want to believe who it really belongs to. Realistically, it's one of those situations where I think the international community, and even some Egyptians, would say, sure, that belongs to Sudan. But because Egypt has refused any, you know, like, international, resolution making on it, they're just like, you know, none of that. It's never probably going to switch hands. And because it's not even connected to the rest of Sudan, and because of all these other reasons that it's not that important to fight over, it probably just won't come up until later when something's discovered there. So let's just hope they don't find oil or something. So moving on from that, we have the border with Libya, because again, this border is just mostly a straight line. You can't cross it in any way, because Egypt and Sudan have no official border crossings other than by a river. And it leads to the funny situation where if you want to go from here, let's say, you know, Abu Simbi right here, you want to go from here into the rest of Sudan, the way you do that, according to Google, is you go all the way around, catch a ferry, and then the ferry takes you there instead. There is no land crossing between, Sudan and between Egypt, meaning if you want to go from there to there, this is the route you take. It's ridiculous, but it's how you have to do things. So the border with Egypt and Libya is, it's an interesting one actually, because both these countries, even though Egypt is much bigger in terms of economy and in terms of population, they have had a little bit of a spat, but then before the spat, they actually existed as part of the same country. So here is the United Arab Republic, and here is the Federation of Arab Republics. That's right, Egypt's been in two separate countries, trying to unite all the Arab countries together, and you know, this one actually included Libya, and then a few years after they broke away, because even though all countries wanted it and they all had referendums that went massively in their favor, you know, they couldn't decide on the terms, so they all split eventually, and then shortly afterwards, Egypt and Libya got in a little bit of a war, you know? Who doesn't have a war every now and then? Get your feelings out for each other. It was actually pretty amicably solved in the end, and that's kind of nice, but it's something you got to keep in mind that, like, oh yeah, they had a war here recently, so not too friendly. However, again, their border is mostly, you know, it looks huge on paper. It looks like it'd be a nightmare to administer, but the truth is like, no one is crossing the western, it's called the Western Desert in Egypt. Like, I know that's not very specific, but that's just what Egypt calls it. So Egypt's Western Desert is just like, no one is crossing this anyway. So it mostly just comes down to one border crossing right up here by the coast, in Salem. As you can see, there is one way to cross the border, one way to cross back. That is the Egypt-Libya border in terms of most things. And in case you're curious, is why it's straight and then it goes here. This is following like ancient, like basically it goes back to way back from the like tribal and stuff boundaries, and it just like, you know, let's just keep that border for the most part. And the straight line took them all the way down to the Sudan border. Again, this was agreed between the UK or the British Empire, and then part of the, like, it's like an Italian ruled Libya. It's confusing. Europe and Africa, it's a mess. But there you go, there's one border crossing. It goes a little jaggedy here, right here, because it just follows historical patterns, you know, to make sure that, like, the Libyans are on the Libyan side and the Egyptians can be on their side. And it mostly doesn't matter which side the land belongs to, because it's mostly following the straight line anyway, just making sure that it gets everyone here. And this part of land right here, you know, that looks a little bit dodgy, couldn't work out the reason for that at all. If you know it, let me know, because again, it's just like random piece of land that looks, you know, questionable, and it is also there on OpenStreetMap. So yeah, there you go. There is the Egyptian-Libyan border explained. It's so easy. They have one border crossing, and then just a lot of, like, nothingness. Like, seriously, a lot of nothingness. So yeah, moving on from that, by the way, here's one of the oases I was talking about, because although most of it is desert, there is the occasional, you know, respite with an oasis, you know, some water in the desert where some people live, so you can see a few people's here, but then it's mostly just nothingness again until you go all the way for there. So yeah, long distance between oases, although Egypt is actually slowly setting those up, and you're seeing how they're also using, like, irrigation to, like, set up land here. It's tricky to do, and it makes these really weird patterns of the earth, but it's a thing that you'll see in Egypt a lot. So let's move to the other side of Egypt, to the Sinai Peninsula, because although it looks like Egypt borders a bunch of countries here, like, oh yeah, Egypt borders like Jordan and Saudi Arabia too, right? They actually only border Israel, and debatably, on your political opinions, because that's how the international politics of this area works, but debatably, they border Palestine too. So for the sake of this video, I'm just going to say they do, because that's how both sides see it. So sue me, you know, like, don't sue me, like, just leave a mean comment about how you think I shouldn't recognize Palestine, or how you think that I should recognize Palestine, I'm being too, you know, half-assed about it. Whatever you want to do, comment section. So they border the Gaza Strip right here, and the border between Egypt and the Gaza Strip is one of, you know, the smallest borders. However, they do have a border crossing here, and the rest of the border is very heavily fortified. And I mean, like, very heavily fortified. They built a huge steel wall here because, again, lots of weapons were getting across the border. It was a real problem for both Egypt and for the US, who they're kind of allied with right now. Again, international, you know, like, relations, a little bit complex when it comes to Egypt because of their location in the world and stuff like that. But long story short, there's a huge, heavily fortified border with, you know, the Gaza Strip here, which was built by Egypt, and then their border with Israel, which again, mostly follows a straight line, a little bit less because they had to, you know, give this to Egypt and so on and so forth. The entire border between Israel and Egypt actually is, you know, fortified with a fence. It looks something like this the entire way down. So this was built by, you know, Israel just a few years ago, surprisingly, in my opinion, like less than 10 years ago, and it actually does stop all of the people from, you know, Africa illegally getting into Israel, it seems. So I guess there's something about that. Like, I wanted to mock this, but it's like, oh, they spent like this amount on it, they got it done. It's like, fair enough, I guess, if that works for you. So the entire border, you can't cross it, except for this one point down here near Taba. So this is the one border crossing between the two countries. And because, you know, basically, let's just be very simple on this one. Israel and Egypt don't get along very well. And the extent of that is, you know, because Israel and Arab countries in general, they don't get along very well at all. And because of that, you know, Israel even occupied this entire peninsula until the 70s. at which point they had to sign a treaty to give it back, which meant that Egypt was the first country to recognize Israel in any way. And then in the 90s, they eventually even finalized a border crossing, which is over here. However, even though they officially have a border crossing, and that's a thing that does exist, it's really, 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 again, they don't really have great relations. And it's to the extent where, like, well, actually, fun fact, actually, if I show you the road crossing, Israel demands that, like, it's blurred out so you can't see anything of the border crossing. Just, like, there's a blur over there where there might be a border crossing. But essentially, if you're from Israel and you want to cross the border, you have to switch your license plate out to be an Israeli one. You have to pay a separate tax at the border. There's a bunch of different stuff you have to do before you can get in the country. And yeah, basically, the two countries have a border, but it's not the friendliest of ones in the world. And it has literally one border crossing up along the entire stretch. And again, apparently, by Middle Eastern standards for Israel, that's like pretty good, apparently. So again, not making comments on the whole thing, that's not my point today. It's just kind of interesting they have this huge border, it's all fenced off, and then it leads to one point right here on the, near the sea right here. So, yeah, basically that is the Sinai Peninsula and what it borders, mostly Israel. It's mostly just like wool, again, like the entire way down the thing, it's just like wall and wall and wall and wall and wall. And that's pretty insane that that's a real thing that exists. And it, apparently they built a wall, and apparently, I guess, like, again, but in the case of like Israel, a little bit different, I think. So yeah, there you go. That's the Sinai Peninsula basically explained. There's also, before we go here, however, there's an interesting territorial dispute with Saudi Arabia. So yeah, basically these islands right here are officially part of Egypt, but Egypt doesn't want them to be. So again, Egypt and territorial disputes, like, they don't do great with them. So they claim these islands belong to them because when the Suez Canal was built, they used them for some workers, and they had some historical, precedent. However, Saudi Arabia says, well, they're closer to us, so ours, maybe? And they had a little bit of a debate, not a big one because they're unpopulated and pretty much worthless. They had a little bit of debate over them for some time. However, in 2016, the Egyptian president said, actually, have your islands, we recognize them, because relations between Saudi Arabia and Egypt are something both sides want to improve. You know, they get some money, they get some diplomatic stuff, they get some friendship, it's all good stuff. However, even though the president said, yep, you can have them, they're yours, the parliament of Egypt has not ratified it, and they, you know, like, they're trying to, like, find ways out of it. So yeah, you're in this really weird situation where Egypt doesn't want these islands, but still has them anyway, and neither Egypt nor Sudan wants this right here. And yeah, fun thing about territorial disputes in the Middle East is they lead to stuff like this. So that is a brief explanation of Egypt and its borders, Egypt and its current situation. It's very wacky, and they only have, again, I want to really clarify this, there is three ways to get in and out of Egypt by land. There is one with Libya, one with the Gaza Strip, which is, you know, you realistically won't do it if you're a tourist, and then one with Israel, again, if you're a normal person. And that's just how intensely, like, even though you have a lot of border, if most of it's unusable, it doesn't matter what straight shape it's in. Like, again, if you're going to have a border between two major countries with a lot of crossings, having a straight line, it's going to cause tribal issues. But when it comes to Egypt, again, their straight line borders that haven't, you know, been redone are mostly okay. Again, they just about function because no one's crossing them anyway. It's just a, you know, delimitation of like, oh yeah, one day we might put something there and this side belongs to us and this side belongs to you. And I actually want to explain the straight line border thing and just say, yeah, straight line borders, terrible idea most of the time, but if it's an area that neither side is using right now, it's a good, like, easy way to divide it. Like, okay, if you're gonna divide a pizza between two people, you divide it in half. If you've eaten half the pizza, you've put toppings on some parts, and, you know, like, some of it's moldy, you cut in a really weird way to make sure neither of you gets the mold, or, you know, you share the mold evenly or something, and that you get the toppings you want, they get the toppings they want, and that the pizza can decide where it gets to live. The analogy is breaking down. But if it's just a fresh pizza, and you know what, this desert right here, right now it's just a fresh pizza, no one's done anything with it, they'll divide it in half. They'll take their fair share, and the straight line border actually does work in that case. So again, you can mock the British, or you can mock Egypt, or you can mock any country for having straight line borders. But if it's in an area such as a desert with no border crossings and no civilization for miles, you know, it just about works. So yeah, thank you very much for watching today's second channel video. I hope you did all enjoy it. before we go, I want to mention again, all the borders videos are available on Reddit. I've also made a playlist of them all if you're curious. I like doing this. I've even got like the little thumbnail green thing on there. I don't know, I like that personally. And thank you so much for watching, and I guess I'll see you all in my next border video, which you know, we've finally done an African country. There's a couple of other ones I'm looking at, and maybe they'll come up next, or maybe we'll do Switzerland because that's that. But yeah, thank you very much for watching. Second channel, don't care. Goodbye.